Gün ikinci oturumuna hoş geldiniz. Bu seansa başlamadan önce konferans programının özet ve özet kitapçığının kopit.org.tr adresinde bulunduğunu hatırlatmak istiyorum. Bu oturumda 4 tane sunum olacak. Onları da İngilizce olarak gerçekleştireceğiz. O yüzden ben de sunumu İngilizce yapacağım. Bu sunum YouTube'da da toplantının YouTube kanalında canlı olarak yayınlanıyor. Toplantıdan sonra da konuşmaları oradan dinleyebileceksiniz diye umuyorum. Şimdi İngilizceye geçeyim. Welcome and welcome back everyone. This is the second session of the sixth meeting on quantum optics and quantum information, COBIT-5. In this session, we are going to have four talks. Three of them will be short talks, and we have one invited talk. I will remind the speakers before 2 minutes before the end of their talk, if necessary, to comply with the time. Let me remind you that the program is available on the meeting's website, cobit.org.tr. You can also find the Book of Abstracts there with some other information. Let me also kindly remind you that this session is also being live streamed on YouTube, on the meeting's YouTube channel, and hopefully will be available also after the meeting. So without further delay, let me introduce the first speaker, Belkıs Gökbulut from Boğaziçi University. So her talk is titled Enhanced Spontaneous Emission of Fluorescent Molecules Coupled into Quasi-Optical Modes in Random Media. Belkıs, please.
Okay. Today, my presentation is about enhanced spontaneous emission of fluorescent molecules coupled into quasi-optical modes in random media. First of all, I will talk about spontaneous emission rate. The modification of spontaneous emission is considered to be at the heart of light matter interaction in the area of photonics after Einstein's proposal in 1917 that spontaneous emission would occur if radiation and matter are to realize thermal equilibrium. So in Einstein's proposal, spontaneous emission rate was considered to be an inherent property of matter and it is directly proportional to equation one. And after that, density of electromagnetic modes was defined by Paul Dirac in 1927. So finally, Edward Purcell in 1946 declared the fact that the probability of spontaneous emission is controlled by geometry of space. So when a quantum source is placed inside a photonic cavity structure, the density of photon states changes to allow controlling the spontaneous emission rate of the emitters. So in our study, I mean, quasi-optical modes, artificial photonic cavities are created to alter the spontaneous emission dynamics of the quantum sources by manipulating the density of electromagnetic states based on Anderson localization. Firstly, Anderson localization is a wave phenomena which originates from the interference of the electromagnetic waves in random structures. So multiple elastic light scattering in a disordered medium may cause creation of various artificial photonic cavities which are capable of trapping photons at particular frequencies and rendering them to have distinctive spectral and spatial profiles. So the nature of the Anderson localized modes is similar to that of the optical modes produced by commercially fabricated well-designed photonic cavities. In the first part of our study, transverse Anderson localized modes are firstly generated inside a simple wedge type optical waveguide, as you see here, through excitation of the dye molecules embedded into the structure. A probing beam entering the disordered medium of the waveguide structure, consisting of air inclusions within the polymeric medium of the waveguide, is demonstrated here. The different colored regions, as you see here, describe the intensity distribution of the interference pattern due to transverse Anderson localization. In our study, transverse Anderson localized modes are accomplished through several single optical modes appearing at different emission wavelengths within the spectral bandwidth of rhodamine 6G dye molecules. And the photonic design of the structure allows guidance of single dominant Anderson mode and suppression of the others. In the second part of the study, the hyperbolic optical waveguides, which enable generation of single, double, and multiple Anderson localizations, are also formed to investigate the effect of an individual localized cavity on the spontaneous emission dynamics of the quantum sources. So the wedge-type optical waveguides are produced inside a triangular air hole, as you see here, which is embedded into a few silica optical material. So the solution of rhodamine 6G and phenol is being thrown into the air hole by Kepler process. As the solution is incorporated into the structure, randomly distributed air bubbles with various dimensions are formed during the Kepler process to serve as scattering medium for the photons. The corners of the air hole provides us three-dimensional wedge-type optical waveguides, as you see here, with distinctive characteristics. So the SAM and fluorescence microscopic images of the cross-sectional faces of the wedge-type optical waveguides are demonstrated in figure A and B, respectively. So waveguide one within this rectangular region is depicted in detail in figure C, as you see here, to actually tell the Anderson localization and to show the actually capillary effect within the waveguide structure. In our study, transverse Anderson localization arises from the interference of the electromagnetic waves in this kind of disordered polymeric waveguide medium. A fluorescent molecule is excited by a laser beam, and also air bubbles, which are illustrated by these blue colored spheres, serve as scattering centers within the polymeric medium. So when the localization length is comparable with the wavelength of light, then the scattered light waves return to the same spot to constitute a loop, trapping photons at particular frequencies and generating Anderson localized modes. So the hyperbolic optical waveguides are also produced inside this 3D microtube with a deltoid shaped cross-sectional area, as you see here, using the same capillary process at the same conditions. So the SAM and fluorescence microscopic images of the hyperbolic optical waveguides are demonstrated in figure A and B, respectively. So each waveguide shown as bright spots in this figure actually ensures a number of coupled optical modes based on geometry and thickness of the waveguide itself. So this figure also shows the excitation of a dipole embedded into the hyperbolic optical waveguide structure. So in our experiment, time-resolved experiments based on time-correlated single photon counting technique are performed to characterize the coupling dynamics between the specific dye molecules and the specific Anderson localized modes at certain frequencies. So in the optical setup used in our experiments is demonstrated here. In our study, transverse Anderson localized modes actually are explored firstly through sharp spectral resonance peaks by photoluminescence spectra of the dye molecules under high excitation power at the wavelength of 550 nanometers, as you see here. Once an Anderson localized mode is obtained, then high power laser beam is blocked by a shutter, and then time is of fluorescence lifetime measurements are performed to investigate the spontaneous emission dynamics of the dye molecules coupled into the individual localized optical modes. So the experimentally obtained 2D and 3D fluorescence intensity distributions of the dye molecules coupled into single Anderson localized mode in wedge waveguide one are demonstrated in figure A and B. In our study, the emitted light is collected from the sample phase through our confocal microscopic setup. And when the background signal is removed from figure A, then this sharp spectral resonance, like a lasing spot confined between two cavity walls, is obviously seen. So the fluorescence lifetime decay curves of the excited emitters coupled into the Anderson localized modes in wedge waveguide one and also in bulk material are demonstrated in figure A. The characteristics of the decay populations of the own resonant emitters of mode one, mode two, and mode three are observed to be quite different from one another, which elucidates that actually the emissions from the dye molecules coupled into the optical modes are localized with distinctive electromagnetic states due to the random configurations of the scattering centers within the polymeric medium. So the corresponding PL spectra of the dye molecules coupled into mode one, mode two, and mode three also are demonstrated here. Each optical mode appears at random spectral and spatial position within the actually spectral bandwidth of rhodamine 6G dye molecules. So in our study, to understand the random nature of the light localization in an entirely three-dimensional disordered waveguide medium, our time result experiments based on time correlated single photon counting technique actually are performed systematically at least 10 times. I mean, at the same conditions and using the same capillary tube. And each time after the specific Anderson nuclease mode is obtained, then its decay rate is recorded by our optical setup. So this figure shows the fluorescence lifetime distribution of the emitters coupled into the specific Anderson nuclease modes in the wedge waveguide structure. The spontaneous emission rate enhancement factors of the emitters coupled into quasi-optical modes actually is calculated to be changing from 2 to 7 according to our experimental results. So the variance of the enhancement factors is also calculated to characterize the random nature of the light localization in an entirely two-dimensional disorder waveguide medium based on this equation, which is equal to 2.5 according to our experimental results. And this value is comparable with the previously reported variance values of the postal factors for the Anderson nuclease modes, I mean, generated inside the disordered photonic crystal waveguide structures. And in our study, I mean, the total fluorescence originates from both on-resonant and off-resonant emission. The on-resonant emission is attributed to the fastest decay rate in the total PL, which is corresponding to the emitters coupled into the specific Anderson nuclease cavities in the waveguide medium. And the theoretical and experimental enhancement factors are also calculated based on these two equations. In the theoretical enhancement factor, the first term represents the Purcell formula, and second and third terms represent the spectral and spatial mismatching between the individual dye molecules and the specific Anderson nuclease modes. Since in our study, actually, Anderson nuclease modes appear at random spectral and spatial positions, and also the dye molecules are also randomly distributed within the waveguide structure in our study. Their coupling into the specific Anderson nuclease modes are distinctive for each case. So the taking average of actually these parts gives us the average value of the spontaneous emission rate enhancement factor in our study. The mode volume values are also calculated based on these two equations. And the mode volume values are also numerically calculated, actually. When we look at the results, we can clearly say that, actually, they are in very good agreement with each other. Similar results from the Anderson localized modes were also obtained by disordered photonic crystal waveguide structures, as seen in these two figures, I mean. Strongly localized Anderson modes were generated by adding an extra disorder to a well-designed photonic crystal cavity structure. So as the strongly localized Anderson peaks appear, in random spectral and spatial positions, as you see in figure C, the spontaneous emission rate of the quantum emitters was demonstrated to be enhanced by a factor of 15 on resonance with the specific Anderson localized mode in this study. So the numerical calculations also have been performed by 3D finite difference time domain technique, and the electric field distribution profiles of the radiating dipoles coupled in the single Anderson localized mode in wedge waveguide 1R demonstrated here in these figures. Each random configuration of the scattering centers is observed to give a different localization of the electromagnetic waves in our study. As it is clearly seen from these figures, that it is also illustrated that actually, when the thickness of the waveguide is about 600 nanometers, then the photonic design of the structure allows guidance of single dominant Anderson mode and suppression of the others, similar to our experimentally obtained results. So the electric field intensity distribution profile of a radiating dipole, three coupling in the three distinctive Anderson nuclease cavities in wedge waveguide 2 is also demonstrated in figure A, which shows that increasing the thickness of the waveguide allows multimode guidance of the electromagnetic waves, Anderson nuclease modes. So it is also experimentally verified by the PL spectrum of the dye molecules coupled into Anderson nuclease modes in wedge waveguide 2, as you see here in figure B. It shows three sharp spectral resonant peaks corresponding to three different Anderson nuclease modes at different emission wavelengths. So the PL spectra of the dye molecules through coupling in the single mode, double mode, and multimode Anderson localizations in hyperbolic optical waveguides are demonstrated here. So each waveguide has specific optical and geometrical properties to have distinctive guidance mechanism for the Anderson localized modes. So the fluorescence decay curves of the excited emitters coupled into the Anderson nuclease cavities in hyperbolic optical waveguides and also in bulk material are demonstrated here. It is clearly seen that, I mean, an obvious change in the characteristics of the decay populations of the emitters coupled into the Anderson localized modes with reference to the emitters in bulk material is seen clearly from this figure. So the actually electric field distribution profiles of the dye molecules, of the dipoles of the dye molecules through coupling in the single mode, double mode, and multi-mode Anderson localizations in hyperbolic optical waveguides are also demonstrated here, which also confirms our experimental results for the hyperbolic optical waveguide structures. So in our study, I mean, to prove the occurrence of Anderson localizations, the numerical calculations have been performed by removing the scattering centers from the polymeric medium of the waveguide structure. So which means, as you see here in figure A, no air bubble inclusions within the polymeric medium. So as it is clearly seen that the strongly localized light governed by the scattering centers within the polymeric waveguide medium disappears to allow guidance of highly extended waveguide mode radiating from the dipole. So the impact of Anderson localization is also confirmed by reducing the refractive index contrast between the host polymeric medium and the scattering centers of the air bubbles, actually. So by taking the refractive index of the host medium to be constant and gradually decreasing the refractive index of the scattering centers from the values of 1.5 to 1.1, which shows that scattering strength plays a crucial role in Anderson localization. So all in all, I mean, in the final actually simulations, so the electric field distribution profiles actually coupled into the Anderson localized mode in hyperbolic optical waveguides also are manifested here to explore the localization dynamics of the optical modes in which the regime of Anderson localization is elucidated. So according to our numerical calculations, we can clearly say that the scattering strength, reducing the scattering strength and also filling fraction factor of the scattering centers decrease the impact of transverse Anderson localization. And finally, I can clearly say that the transverse Anderson localization in an entirely three-dimensional disordered waveguide medium is achieved for the first time by our studies. And in addition to this, the coupling of quantum sources into the specific Anderson localized cavities is also demonstrated as an alternative to actually manipulate the density of photon states and to alter the spontaneous emission rate of the quantum emitters, I mean, significantly. So thank you for listening. These are the related journal articles.
Thank you, Berkus, for this nice and well-timed presentation. So I think we can take one or two questions while I check the chat box. Let me ask you the first question. So I know Anderson localization depends on the dimensionality. So here you have this hyperbolic geometry. Does it, is it, what's the role and does it, is it because of some practical concern that you are choosing this or?
Yeah, that is hyperbolic waveguide structure. Yes, that is actually, of course, it depends on dimensionality, but actually that is a micro tube. I mean, that's a Kepler tube in microscale, but we are obtaining the Anderson localization in our study from the actually those parts. And those parts actually, as you see here, the waveguide, the dimension of this waveguide, for instance, is about 500 nanometers. So it always actually allows guidance of one single dominant Anderson mode in this study. I mean, of course, that is a microtube in microscale, but we are taking the Anderson localization from that cross section and it is its dimension is about 500 nanometers. And also Anderson localization actually arises from the interference of the electromagnetic waves in this kind of disordered polymeric medium. I mean, the scattering dimensions of the scattering centers also actually are so important, are crucial to obtain Anderson localization in our study.
Thank you. So Humaira Çağlayan is asking, what is the length of the waveguide? Maybe you showed or mentioned, but
yeah, actually the waveguide, it is very long. It is 4 centimeter, which is long enough for backscattering of the photons, actually. And also it is also long enough to transmit the excitation beam into the waveguide structure.
Thank you. I don't see any other questions at the moment. So considering the time, I suggest that we move on and go ahead with the second talk.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you again. So the second, our second speaker in the second session today is Enderalp Yakaboylu from Max Planck Institute in Garching near Munich. His talk is titled Molecular Impurities as a Realization of Anions on the Two Sphere. So Enderalp, you have 25 minutes. Also, please unmute yourself.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Okay, thank you very much for this kind introduction. So I will talk about anions, particular anions on the two sphere, and I will try to realize these anions in terms of molecular impurities. So let me start my motivation. I mean, as you know, all over the world, the main research is going in the direction of quantum computers. All over the world, there are lots of groups working on it. In fact, from the conceptual point of view, all these tools somehow well established. But from the physical point of view, from the experimental point of view, there are some problems. The main challenge, the main problem is, in fact, noise decoherence, which means that, in fact, we shouldn't lose quantums of these particles that we want to manipulate all this computation. Therefore, in fact, main challenge in quantum computers is to be able to construct fault-tolerant computation or error-correcting computation. And one of the promising way to overcome this problem, in fact, to use topology. I mean, topology by its name is robust against somehow local deformation, and somehow we can avoid such kind of noises. And in fact, Kitaev came up with a very nice idea, and he showed that certain quasi-particle excitations called anions can be used to construct such quantum computation. So far, so good. Then the problem is, then the question is, where are these anions? In fact, a few months ago, I read an interview from Kitaev and Preskill, and they admit that the experimental progress on anions is much slower than they expected. So let me start. Let me show my outline. So in the first part, I will talk about anions, what those particles are, what is the relation between gauge fields, and how can we realize these emergent anions. Then I will pass to my main part, which is about molecular impurities. Then later, I will slightly switch the focus of my talk. I will talk about symmetries, but at the end, I will show that this is also related to anions, and I will conclude my talk at the end. So let's start with anions. As you know, according to Spin-Stutz theorem, if you swap two particles, then you will obtain a phase factor, which is given by minus one to two s. S is the spin of your particle. It could be either integer or half integer. In fact, you can write down this swapping exchange properties in two-body wave function in relative coordinates. So for example, if you define this two-body wave function in relative coordinates, and if you rotate pi, then you will obtain a phase factor, which is given by e to the I alpha pi. Here, alpha is called statistical parameter. If alpha equals zero, you have bosons, basically. If alpha equals one, you have fermions. So basically, it characterizes your symmetries, whether your wave function is symmetric or anti-symmetric. But this statement is true only in 3+1 dimensional space-time. Why? You know, we classify all these particles in terms of Poincaré group, and the Poincaré group can be mapped to SO3 for massive particles, and you can show that SO3, just using the Lie algebra, admits some of spin quantization. So spin could be either integer or half integer. But if you lower your dimension, for example, if you go to 2+1 dimensional space-time, then you can still start from the Spin-Stutz theorem, but this time, the little group or the Wigner group goes to SO2, and SO2 is just abelian group. It's just you can rotate either in clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction. And there is no non-trivial Lie algebra, and spin is not quantized in this sense. Therefore, spin can assume any number. Therefore, the statistical parameter alpha can assume any number between 0 and 1. That's why these particles now obey any statistics. That's why they are called anions. But there's a strange thing happening here. If you rotate one more time, So this means that if you exchange twice, then you will not end up with the same configuration. So basically, you have unusual boundary conditions. So in relative coordinates, your wave function will not be single valued. You will obtain a phase factor given by e to the I pi 2 pi alpha. If, of course, alpha equals 0 or 1, you end up with the same thing. But if alpha assumes any number, then it will be different. This is, in fact, where topology enters the game. So exchanging unions twice is not topologically equivalent to leaving them alone. So this is so-called braiding. And this is where, in fact, how you can store the information. Okay. But of course, we know we live at least in a 3+1 dimensional world. So this means that there cannot exist unions at the elementary level. But nevertheless, we can mimic these particles. How? As I told you, the two-body wave function is not single-bodied. But of course, you can apply some gauge transformation, and you can still write down a single-bodied wave function. For example, assume that your psi prime, which is multi-valued, is governed by some Hamiltonian H prime. And the relevant quantity is del over del phi. And if you apply some gauge transformation, you will obtain a single-bodied wave function, which means that your Hamiltonian, transformed Hamiltonian, on symmetric or anti-symmetric wave functions. But there's a price to pay. The price is the following. After this transformation, the relevant quantity del over del phi, which is angular momentum, goes to del over del phi plus I alpha. So now the statistic parameter emerges as a gauge field. So in this picture now, unions can be described as bosons or fermions interacting with the statistical gauge field. This is, in fact, where the complication starts. In fact, this picture also allows us to realize unions in our world. How? In fact, this is how we check the unions. Consider, for example, a composite called flux to charge particle composite, which means that you have an electron orbiting around a flux tube. Now consider two composites, and let us exchange these composites. So after swapping, one of the charge particles of the one of the composite will capture the Ahrenbaum phase of the flux of the other composite. So this is, in fact, the manifestation of anion. So under exchange, you can capture a phase factor. Of course, this is just intuitive. If you go to more than two particles, things are a bit complicated, but there's, in fact, more rigorous way to define this statistical gauge field, which is, in fact, Chern-Simons picture. You know, in 2+1 case, apart from Maxwell theory or Young-Mills theory, there's another gauge invariant coupling, which is Chern-Simons form. If you couple, for example, matter field to Chern-Simons, and if you find the equation of motion, then you will find the statistical gauge field. And now the corresponding Hamiltonian for n particles now is given by this. So A is here the statistical gauge field and given by some holonomy of the gauge field. Okay, so this is the basic formalism. And we know that, in fact, the excitations in the fractional quantum Hall effect are basically unions. They obey fraction statistics. But there are some still problems. So experimental evidence, at least experimental manipulation of these quasi-particles is still challenging. And to be honest, this experimental evidence is not yet conclusive and still debate, although there are some recent progress. So my point is the following. How can we realize these unions in a more simple problem, in a more standard condensed matter system like crystal lattice or ultra-cold gases? We can use this emerging gauge field feature. For example, let us consider n impurities given by the first term. And let us couple these impurities with a bat, some mini particle environment. And for simplicity, let us assume that the phonon field has only 1 degree of freedom. We consider single phonon mode, which is given by a degree a. And this is the interaction. So lambda is coupling, omega is your dispersion, and f is your holonomy, somehow which should produce the statistical gauge field. So if we apply some transformation, somehow to diagonalize your minibody part, you will end up with this equation. And if you also diagonalize this Hamiltonian in the base of Fock space, you will do the following. You will basically take the matrix element from the vacuum to one phonon state, and so on. Now, here's the thing. If the gap between the vacuum sector and one phonon sector is very large, which is controlled by dispersion relation omega, then the vacuum sector will decouple from the rest of the spectrum. And in this case, the lowest spectrum of your impurity Hamiltonian corresponds to anions. So Now, using these pictures, let us define anions on the two sphere. First of all, why I am interested in anions on two sphere? I mean, so far, all these experimental realization on anions is focusing on anions on the plane. But we know that the topology and geometry plays a significant role for quantum statistics. And also, we can also understand in a better way some certain phenomena like fraction quantum Hall effect and so on. So let us try to realize these anions on the two sphere. So there are some subtleties. First of all, in contrast to plane case, in order to find the magnetic potential A, the statistical engagement A, you have to introduce two charges for the sphere. So in the plane case, you can find always single magnetic potential, but for S2, due to non-trivial homology of S2, you have to introduce two charges. Basically, you have to remove one point from the sphere and you have to map the plane, and you have to do the same thing other way around, such that you have to remove another opposite point, for example, from antidote, then you have to again map the plane and so on. But the point is that in the overlap patch, the solutions should be equivalent to each other. And this equivalence is secured by so-called Dirac quantization condition. And this is where, in fact, the statistic parameter depends on the geometry. As you see, for example, on the sphere case, the statistic parameter can assume only some certain values. For example, in the plane case, this statistic parameter alpha can assume from 0 to 1, but in the sphere, it only depends on the number of particles also. For example, if you have just 2 particles, then the statistic parameter is just integer again. In order to obtain fractional values, you have to go to higher number of particles. Okay, for example, let us consider the simplest case. So for example, just 2 particles on the sphere, and let us couple these 2 particles to a bat. Again, the first term is just the Laplacian on the sphere, the kinetic energy of those 2 particles. Again, I'm assuming that there is only one phonon mode, and this phonon mode couples to these infinities. And these Fs are, again, the holonomy of field. So, as I told you, on the sphere, if you have just 2 particles, then statistic parameter assumes only integer values. But I would like to see the whole interpolation from bosons to fermions or from fermions to bosons. In order to achieve these ones, we also consider additional Dirac monopole field. Under this condition now, the Dirac quantization condition will be different. In this case, for example, the condition is given by 2b minus n minus 1 times alpha should be integer. And since b could be any number, then the alpha can assume any number. So let us see the result. So this is the spectrum as a function of the relative statistic parameter. It's not absolute one, it's relative. We plot this in order to be consistent with the existing literature. And here, alpha equals 0 corresponds to fermionic end, and alpha equals to 1 corresponds to bosonic end. And as you see, the spectrum clearly interpolates between fermionic end to bosonic end. And this is, we obtain this solution just solving the imputer model in the limit of omega goes to infinity. Okay, so in fact, this approach provides us some numerical tools, but also we can also realize these particles. First of all, what we need is a Laplacian on the sphere. But if you consider the mathematical structure of Laplacian on the sphere, it's nothing but angular momentum operator. An angular momentum operator, in fact, is the kinetic energy of a linear molecules or linear rotors. So this means that I can realize these impurities with linear molecules. But this is very interesting. For example, consider 2 molecules. And now, I'm not exchanging these molecules. I'm not swapping these molecules. I'm just playing their rotations. Just playing their rotations, for example, I can exchange the corresponding point particles on the sphere. So this is very important. So this means that if you immerse molecules or if you couple these molecules to a bat, then there should exist some kind of exclusion principle for these molecular impurities due to the statistical interaction. But there is another important thing. Since here, the statistic parameter manifests itself in the alignment of molecules. And we know that the alignment of molecules is easy to access experimentally. Since, you know, in the big challenge about observing anions, how to detect this statistical parameter. And this is really a promising way. Okay, this is how we realize impurities. But what about the coupling? How can we realize the bad and so on? In fact, this is also possible. This is also feasible. In fact, recently it was shown that molecular impurities rotating inside the helium nanodroplets can be described within quantum impurity problems. In fact, the resulting quasi-particle is called angulon, and it describes the angular momentum exchange between the molecules and the bath. And now we can write down the corresponding Hamiltonian of the angulon given by equation 6. For those who are familiar with the Frobenius polaron, this is very similar to Frobenius polaron problem. So the first term is just the kinetic energy of the impurities. The second term is just dispersion relation of phonons. And the last term is just interaction. So here, omega KLM, sum of dispersion. Here, I expanded creation relation operators in spherical basis such that it is now transparent to see this exchange of angular momentum. And YLM is just spherical harmonics, and UKL just some coupling. Okay. So remember, in order to achieve the anionic spectra, we need a gap dispersion relation. How can we satisfy this one? So if you have a look at the dispersion relation of helium nanodroplets, you will see it is similar to this red line. And there exists a certain gap, which is called Rotom minimum. And if you manage to somehow concentrate your interaction around Rotom minimum, then you can obtain this gap. Furthermore, in order to obtain a huge gap, now we can consider, for example, heavy molecules. So if you scale your Hamiltonian with the mass of your molecules, then effective dispersion relation will be just Rotom minimum times the mass. And when the mass goes to infinity, then you will obtain a huge gap, and the lowest spectrum will decouple from the rest of the spectrum. In fact, this is basically adiabaticity. Furthermore, we can also couple, we can also find the model coupling, which describes this molecular interaction in helium nanodroplet. In fact, this coupling given by equation 7 is quite good to explain the experimental observations. So now let us calculate statistical gauge field. If you calculate statistical gauge field, you will obtain a prefactor, what I call alpha theta. Here, this quantity a priori depends on the relative angle between the molecules. But if you have a look at the graph, and if you tune your parameter such that, you will see that this parameter is almost constant in the long range of theta. So this means that this parameter now behaves like exact statistical parameter. So this is in fact how you realize anion. So basically, if you immerse two molecules in a helium nanodroplet, and if you localize at Rotom minimum, and if you go to high mass limit, then basically low spectrum should obey anionic spectra. Okay, now let me slightly change the focus of my talk. Let us talk about symmetries of quantum impurities, in particular about molecular impurities. So at the moment, forget about all these impurities and bad and phonons and so on. Just consider just linear molecule. Linear molecule, in fact, just rigid rotor in this sense. Or let us consider just single rigid rotor. How would you define the spectra? In fact, you have to start with symmetries, right? The rigid rotor is, by its definition, is rigid. So the symmetry is SO3, just the three-dimensional rotations. And just using these group properties, you can define your Hamiltonian, which is just the operator of your Hamiltonian. And using just algebra, now you can find the spectrum, which is given by J times J plus one, right? Now let us immerse this object in a bath. What's happening in this case? In fact, all this cloud of phonons dresses your molecule, right? And you will obtain a quasi-particle. If in this sense, quasi-particle is more or less a regular particle with a renormalized quantities, like in the polaron case. For example, polaron is just a free electron with a renormalized mass or renormalized charge. This is the same thing. So if you couple a molecule to a bath, then your molecule will be dressed with this excitation of phonons. This means that rigid is now broken due to this cloud of phonons. So this is how we obtain the renormalization rotation constant, or how we obtain quasi-particle. Now the question is the following. Can we find a symmetric group for this angulon or this quasi-particle? So here's the idea. So rigid rotor corresponds to SO3. And now when we immerse in a bath, this rigid is somehow broken. It is getting deformed, so to say. So now idea is the following. Let us deform then SO3. So this is so-called Q deformation. And this is the algebra. And here it looks very similar to regular algebra, but there's a square bracket notation. And this square bracket notation shows that the expression is given by this formula. So here Q is your deformation parameter. When Q goes to one, then you will obtain the regular algebra. And basically Q controls your deformation. So since I know the Lie algebra or commutation relation, now I can define the corresponding Casimir operator. So this means that now I can write down a Hamiltonian for a deformed rotor. This is given by some, again, some rotational constant times some Casimir operator. Since I know also the algebra, I can find the whole spectrum. And the spectrum this time is given by J times J plus one, but in a Q number. Again, if the Q is one, then I will obtain the regular spectrum. Since I know the exact result, now I can also calculate the corresponding normalization with respect to the rigid rotor at any order, since I know the exact result. So here is the idea. For the moment, let us assume that this deformation parameter is small. So let's say one plus epsilon, and I can expand up to any order in epsilon. And also from the impurity problem, let us assume that interaction between the molecules and the bath is not so strong, it is weak. Then I can use perturbation theory and I can calculate this normalization of a rotation constant up to second order. And let us at this order match these two expressions, one from quantum group approach, one from just perturbation theory. And let us extract the Q parameter, this deformation parameter, as a function of parameters of the of your bath, like dispersion relation, coupling, rotation constant, and so on. Now the question is the following. Is this exact or full expression for normalized rotational constant is valid for beyond perturbative regime? So let us check it. So this is the result. So the y-axis is the rotational constant, normalization of rotation constant, and the x-axis is density of your bed or density of or logarithm of rotation constant. The dash red line corresponds to quantum group technique, and the blue lines corresponds to some non-perturbative techniques like variational techniques or diagrammatic Monte Carlo technique. And it looks like our quantum group technique is capturing the non-perturbative things. So this is really nice. So this is our conjecture now. If the symmetry of a free quantum particle corresponds to Lie group G, that in the presence of many body environment, this part can be described by a deformed group GQ. And what is the relation of this approach with anions? In fact, let us have a look at just the standard canonical quantization. How would you do that? In fact, it is just computation of B and B Degger, right? And if it is bosons, you should obtain a minus factor. If it is fermions, since alpha this time is one, then you will obtain additional minus one and it should be plus. But if general, if alpha assumes any number between zero and one, then your commutation relation given by some Q parameter. And this is exactly exact relation between the deformation parameter and anions. In fact, if you look at from more fundamental level, the so-called level parameter of Chern-Simons action, in fact, is nothing but your Q parameter. So with this, I would like to conclude my talk. So basically, the impurity model has some advantages. First of all, really, just the lowest spectrum of the impurity model in the limit of large dispersion corresponds to ionic spectra under certain coordination if the interaction couples in a holonomic way. And this opens up really new and simple numerical approaches to investigate the spectra of many anions. You know, the main challenge for anions, as I told you, even free anion corresponds to interacting bosons. Therefore, to obtain the spectra of many anions is really challenging. So this is one advantage. The second thing, in fact, we can realize these anions in a standard in a standard quantum matter system, really like crystal lattices, ultracold gas, or helium nano droplet. And this really offers important practical advantages over strong correlated materials like quantum Hall equivalent and so on. And of course, as a last thing, with this quantum group technique, Q-deformation technique, we can also find another hint that the impurities can be used as a realization of anions. So with this, and also I would like to thank my collaborators, Misha from IST Douglas, Robert Zeyringer, Nicola, Andy, and with this, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Enderab, for this nice and accessible talk. There was one question from Sergey Borisenok about whether the quantum impurities can be thought of as originating from some degrees of freedom related to, say, quasi-particles in a condensed matter system. Maybe you commented on this, but...
Yeah. Basically, I mean, these quasi-particles is just, if you, for example, consider impurities in some excitations, then this whole composite is called quasi-particle. I mean, somehow in this sense, quantum impurities just individual particles coupled to made by the environment, and quasi-particles in this sense just the dressing of these impurities. Yeah, and you can find in many places. In fact, I mean, from polarized physics to neutron stars, for example, right? For example, in neutron stars, there are also some protons, right? And the protons, in fact, in this sense, behave like impurities. And if you dress these protons with the neutron field, for example, you will obtain, for example, some quasi-particle. I mean, yeah.
Maybe I can also ask a naive question. Is it possible to imagine the deformation parameter in terms of some experimental probes or parameters?
That's a good question. Yeah, I mean, from the conceptual point of view, this deformation parameter is directly related to statistical parameter, and it is really challenging to access the statistical parameter. Therefore, to be honest, I don't know. But you can consider like that, since this Q controls your deformation or fuzziness in this sense, somehow it should relate to your interaction. But the exact symmetry, to be honest, I don't know. I think it is very challenging. So far, I think there is, up to my knowledge, there is only one model I know which admits somehow exact Q deform symmetries. Apart from, I don't know.
Okay, thank you. So let me see if there are any further questions in the chat box, because time-wise we are doing okay. So if there are any other questions, please do not hesitate to pose them right now. Otherwise, Ceyhun Hocam, should we give couple of minutes break before we continue, since we are
yes, we should start at announced time.
Okay, very good. people have urgent business to deal with in a couple of minutes. So while we wait for further questions, maybe a few more, let me also ask the next speaker, Mahir Yeşiller, to sort of speak up and maybe share his screen to test.
Yes, okay. Hello, Hocam. Okay, let me share my screen. Okay. Can you see my screen, Anatolij?
It's coming up, I guess. Yes.
Okay.
All right, so then let us continue with the next talk. Our next speaker is Mahir Yeşiller, who is currently a graduate student at Koç University. So his talk is titled Quantum Information Theory for Fermions and Its Applications in Quantum Biology. So please, Mahir.
Thank you for the introduction, Levent Hocam. Hello everyone, I'm Mahir Yeşiller. I'm working with Onur Pusuluk Hoca and Özgür Müstecaplı Hoca in the TÜBİTAK project of Onur Hoca. In molecules or atoms, the useful correlation may occur due to the mobility of electrons. However, to quantify this correlation...
If I'm not sure if it's just me, but if you change your slide, it's still showing the title page.
Yes, I can. Now
it's working.
And to quantify this correlation, quantum correlation between the molecules or atoms, by using the common quantum information theory, does not seem possible. That is because of the indistinguishability of electrons. Today, firstly, I'm going to present quantum information theory for fermions, and then I will show an application of this theory in quantum biology using our results. To define the correlation between the fermions, there are two different representations. Let us give some example in these two representations. First, consider two atoms which are labeled as 1 and B, A and B, and they are our subsystems. These two atoms share two electrons. We label one of the electron as 1 and the other as 2. And as you see, this state, this wave action seems to be entangled in particle representation. But in the mode representation, we get this state. Because for electron, or generally speaking for fermions, each mode can be occupied or not. We use the double notation to indicate the fermionic mode representation, and this comma is used to separate subsystems from each other. This states show that one of the electron in the atom A and the other in the atom B. And so, as you see, there is no entanglement at all in this representation. Another example is that one electron is shared by two atoms. In this representation, no entanglement is appear. But in mode representation, it seems there's an entanglement between these two atoms. Finally, let's look at the example in which two electrons are shared between two atoms. In this case, entanglement appears in both representation. So based on these examples, we can say that mode representation is more reasonable because electrons are indistinguishable particles. So labeling them as 1 and 2 is meaningless. But in both mode representation, we can easily distinguish which modes from each subsystem. So it becomes possible to define correlation between the distinguishable modes. Since fermionic modes are two-level distinguishable systems, like qubits, mapping between these two systems seems possible. There are well-known maps, such as Jordan-Wigner transformation, map any global fermionic state into qubit state. By taking the partial trace for qubits and taking the redefined partial trace for fermions, we can obtain reduced state rho tilde A and rho A. However, any known mapping does not preserve the subsystem. So this means that we are not able to use the common quantum information theory for fermions. And so we need to do quantum information theory in fermionic mode representation. Before doing so, we encounter another problem, which is the possibility of some fermionic state violating the no-signaling theorem. Let's consider such a fermionic state, which has two single modes, and then choose any observable in subsystem A, and for instance, A the gray plus, and the expectation value of this, this observable gives one in this case. After applying a local operation on the subsystem B, the initial state takes this form. If we again calculate the expected value of observable with respect to this state, it gives minus sum due to the anticommutation relations. So local operation in so it means a local operation in subsystem A affects a local observable in subsystem B A, and which means these two subsystems can communicate faster than light. And this results in the violation of no signaling principle. Actually, the reason of this problem is that we assume such states are allowed in fermionic system, but in fact they are not, because fermions must respect the super selection rule, and which says which forbids any superposition of even and odd fermionic states. Okay, the parity operator easily allow us to find out whatever a fermionic state is odd or even. And in here, there are two examples of fermionic states which are not allowed due to the super selection rule. And this one is the state that give rise to violation of the non-signaling principle. And as you see, it is not allowed due to the super selection rule. And there is another super selection rule. It is not general light, but super selection rule. It is mostly applied to low energy fermionic system, energetic fermionic system. And it says that the number of fermions in the each subsystem must be conserved. This selection rule is very relevant to our study, because the biomolecules we are working on must respect the number super selection rule. Here are some example of fermionic states which comply with super selection rule, but not with the number super selection rule. So since we eliminate the problem of unphysical fermionic states thanks to super selection rule, we can now start to redefine the fermionic quantum operation, which relates to fermionic subsystem, starting with partial trace. The partial trace must comply with the consistency condition to obtain the reduced density state, reduced states. Then taking the partial trace of an M-mod fermionic state over any MI mod, any mod MI, is given like this. And to take this partial trace, the creation operator of mod MI must sweep the creation operator of another mods on the right side, respectively. The same goes for the annihilation operators, annihilation operator. Every sweep results in the minus sign due to the anticommutation relation between them. And the term K gives the number of the sweeps on both sides. As you see, some elements can have a negative sign. So with this definition of the partial trace, we can get the physical reduced fermionic states. Okay, using the same logic, but with more complex process, we can redefine the fermionic partial transpose. As before, due to the anticommutation relation, the partial transpose of the fermionic states can also result in the negative sign. And this definition enables us to apply negativity for fermionic system, which provides a measure for entanglement. Okay. Now, I will talk about how we can use toolbox of fermionic quantum information theory to quantify correlation in biomolecules. We can represent molecular orbitals of a biomolecule as subsystems which consist of two fermionic modes. Therefore, this representation allows us to quantify correlation between the molecular orbitals. And this is the recent article which studies orbital correlation. Here, they use the tensor network to find the ground state of the sun biomolecules. And then they quantified total orbital-orbital correlation between them. And after that, compose this correlation into the quantum and classical parts for the first time in the literature. And they conclude all the quantum correlation are entangled. And as you see in the figure, after the composition, only small amount of the total correlation is entangled. And after applying superselection rule on them locally, most of the entanglement disappear. And as a result, they conclude these molecular systems are not good candidates for quantum technologies. In their work, they use the distance-based measures to quantify the correlations. This is the schematic of this method. And to measure the entanglement of the state row, any state row, they found the closest separable state and then measure the relative entropy between these two states. To measure the total correlation, they found the closest uncorrelated state again. And they said this distance gives the classical correlation, but ignored in some separable states, there may be another quantum correlation beyond the entanglement, such as quantum discord. Therefore, some of the correlation they are labeled as classical correlation should actually be quantum correlation. So, based on this result, we try to properly decompose classical and quantum orbital correlations of some molecules. Find the ground state of the molecules instead of tensor network, we use the well-known quantum chemistry method, which is configuration interaction. So let me try our result in graphs. The first molecule we work is the water molecule. It has 10 electron and 7 molecular orbital. And the graphs show the orbital-orbital correlations. This is the total correlation before applying any superselection rule. And this one after after parity superselection rule, and this one after the number superselection rule. This column shows the entanglement in the same situation, respectively. And here we properly separate the total correlation into the quantum correlation and classical correlation. And we did the same calculation for the carbon ion and the propylene. And the important result we get is that after number superselection rule, even if there is no entanglement between some orbitals, as you can see in here, there is a quantum correlation. So as a result, we are the first one to properly separate the orbital correlations into the classical and quantum parts. And doing so, we show that in some cases, there's a quantum correlation even in the absence of the entanglement. In the rest of the project, we want to show the correlation in more large molecules. For this, we are going to use tensor network and neural networks. So thank you for listening.
Mahir, thank you very much. So we can take a few questions.
Yes, of course.
From the audience. There was the question about how you take the partial trace, define the partial transpose operation. I'm sorry. Maybe you can clarify that while we wait for other questions.
Okay. To take the partial trace for fermions, we need to define a consistency condition to obtain a physical reduced states. And it says if we have a state, a local observable, its expected value must be same if we take the expected value with respect to global state or local state. And the reason of this condition, actually, we cannot define tensor product in fermionic systems, fermionic Hilbert space. And we need the physical restriction. Because of that, we need the physical restriction.
Okay. So there's another question from Zeki Seskir. He's asking if there are any applications to show that Discord without entanglement can provide any quantum advantage for computational purposes.
Actually, I don't know, but in some cases, there's a work, Onur Hoca and Özgür Hoca, they show quantum Discord can be used to reverse the heat flow, but I don't know any application in quantum biology, but it can be, and so that's, I don't know any.
Right, so okay, thank you. I think we can move on to the last talk of this session. So Mahir, thank you one more time. And our next speaker is Gökhan Torun from Koç University. Gökhan, would you share your screen, please?
Yes.
Gökhan is going to talk about resource theory of superposition.
Sorry.
Gökhan, you have 15 minutes.
Can you see my screen?
Let me confirm. Yes, would you, if you would maximize, perfect.
Okay, I am starting. First of all, thanks a lot for the introduction and the opportunity to tell about our work on resource theory of superposition and state transformation. This is a joint work with Hüseyin Kavhara Şenyaş and Ali Yıldız from İstanbul Teknik University. Here is the outline of the content. First, I will give a quick description of quantum resource theories. Then I will continue with the resource theory of superposition. And finally, I will give the definition of our problems and the results that we obtain for deterministic superposition-free transformations. Resource theories, any resource theories consist of three elements. These are free states, free operations, and resource states. The golden rule of the resource theory is that the free operations transform the free states into free states and allow for the resource to be manipulated, but not freely created. The well-known, the most well-known resource theory is entanglement, and the other kind of resource theories are built as an example of entanglement. In the theory of entanglement, our free states are separable states, and our three operations are LOCC, local operations, and classical communications. The states which are not separable or which are not free are called resource. These states are entangled states. Also, there are some other kind of resource theories. For example, coherence, quantum string, asymmetry, atermality, quantum thermodynamic, Bell non-locality. For any quantum resource theories, quantification of these resources is an important problem. Here we have a set of free states, and other states are resource. We take a resource state rho, then we find the closest free states to the row. To obtain this closeness, we use relative entropy of relative entropy. By calculating this distance, one can obtain the resource value of the density matrix row as a resource. Also, resource measures must satisfy some conditions. There are three conditions. The first one is the golden rule of any resource measure. If we have a free state row, then the resource measure must be equal to zero. This is called also non-negativity or faithfulness. The second condition is monotonicity. We know that any resource theory cannot be increased under free operations. Here, lambda is SPCPT completely positive trace preserving map. It is free. It's the free operations for the in the context of resource theories. And the third condition is convexity. Any resource measure must satisfy these three conditions. So before introducing the resource theory of superposition, I want to talk about coherence, because coherence is a special case of superposition. Quantum states that are diagonal with respect to a fixed orthonormal basis I are defined as incoherent and is are given in this form. Here pi are probabilities, and their summation is equal to 1. Then the other states which are not incoherent are called resource state, and they are coherent states, and they are given in this form. For the superposition theory, our basis states are not necessarily orthogonal. They are also normalized and linear independent, but different from the coherence theory, this time our basis vectors are not necessary to be orthogonal. And this is the most important point of the superposition theory. And then the free states are given in this form again. They are diagonal in this basis. And the other states are superposition states or are resource states, and they are given in this form. Here, as I said, the basis vectors are not necessarily orthogonal, so their overlap is different from zero. This mu is between minus one and plus one. Also here, the coefficients are complex. In the previous section, slide, I talked about the resource measure. For the superposition theory, there are two superposition measure. One is relative entropy of superposition, and the other one is L1 norm of superposition. Both of them are given in these forms. Here, rho is given in general in this form. For this work, I will use the L1 norm of superposition. It is equal to the off diagonal term, absolute value, sum of the absolute value of off diagonal terms of the density matrix. So our problem is as follows. We have an initial state psi and a target state phi. Our aim is to transform these states into these states under the free operations, under the superposition free operations. So for superposition theory, our superposition free cross operators are given in this form. Their definition is also are given in this form. If you have a superposition free operator row, then this must be invariant under the any superposition cross operators. So this superposition free cross operators Kn will give us the final states, the target states, with some probability Pn. So here we do not know the index functions. Index functions are fnk. They are not known. I will explain what I mean by this. And here also probabilities are not known. So the superposition cross operators are not known too. Also, conditions for a deterministic superposition free transformations is not known yet. In this work, we answer all these questions. For the index functions, for example, for d equal to 3, there are six possible outcomes, but the problem is that which output will we choose? Is it, for example, 1, 2, 3 or 1, 3, 2 or 3, 2, 1? This is the big problem of the big question of the problem. To define, to correctly define these index functions, we benefit from this paper. In this paper, we give the permutation of the incoherent operators. So, as I said, coherence is a special case of superposition. So we can use these permutations for the superposition theory. Because I don't have too much time, I don't explain the details of these permutations, but we use the results of this paper. Also, another point, another important point is majorization. Majorization is a well condition for coherence and entanglement transformation. It is known. If we have, for example, for the coherence theory, if we have initial state and final states, if the majorization condition satisfied between these states, then these initial states can be transformed to this target state with unit probability. So in principle, a similar approach is highly expected for superposition manipulation. But the problem is highly non-trivial because of the non-orthogonality of basis states. So in our framework, there are the superposition free cross operators. They are given this form. Then different from the coherence theory. In the coherence theory, this set of cross operators is sufficient. But for the superposition theory, we need another set of cross operators. They are Fm. Here, Kn gives the target state with some probabilities, and Fm gives nothing. It is equal to zero. But it is necessary to satisfy this completeness relation. This is the biggest difference from coherence theory. So our result is as follows. Here mu equal to overlap of the basis papers. We define two parameters, PC I tilde and P I tilde. Then majorization for superposition is in this form. If we take the orthonormal limit, then this majorization condition for superposition turns into the well-known majorization condition for coherence. Also here, this majorization for superposition is not sufficient. We need another condition for superposition theory. We call this condition on completeness condition, and it is given in this form. This is also a new condition for the superposition theory. Here, there, the terms omega can be found in this form. Here, P are the permutation matrix. We defined before. Also, probabilities can be found by solving these equations. All the problems can be solved actually by defining index functions f and k correctly. We obtained that majorization condition, condition on completeness, and L1 of superposition must satisfy at the same time for a deterministic transformation. For example, for each region, we can define some transformations. Only the transformations in region one is deterministic. The other transformations cannot be done with unit probability. They can be probabilistic. Our results say that for a deterministic transformation, majorization condition for superposition, condition on completeness, and L1 normal superposition must be satisfied. Lastly, another important subject is resourcefulness. We know that in the top of the hierarchy of resourcefulness, there is maximal states. For example, for coherence theory and entanglement theories, there are maximal states. These are also golden units for these theories. These are important because they are in the top of the hierarchy of the resourcefulness. They are the most effective resources in any quantum information processing task. So what are the question is that what are the maximal superposition states for resource superposition? In the paper of resource error superposition written by Martin Plenio and his collaborators, they show that for superposition theory, maximal resource states only exist for qubit systems, and they say for high dimensional systems there are not maximal states, but we obtain some maximal states for a specific region of scalar product or overlap between the basis vectors. So we obtain these maximal states, maximal resource states for superposition. And conclusion, all these work are important because tools introduced in the resource theory of superposition appear to be a candidate to quantification of coherence in the optical coherence, since optical coherence states are not orthogonal. Also, superposition states can be converted to into entanglement. A connection between superposition and non-orthogonality and entanglement can be found by the tools of superposition theory. This is a summary and some references. Thank you for your time.
Gökhan, thank you very much. And also thank you finishing on time as the previous speakers. I think we can take a couple of questions before we stop for a break, I guess, about half an hour. Mm-hmm. So it may be a naive question, but can you comment on the basis dependence for coherence and superposition? The choice of basis?
We know that coherence is a basis dependent resource theory. So when we define any state as a coherent or incoherent, we initially define the orthonormal phi, orthonormal basis. This is a spatial case for coherence. It's also spatial for coherence theory. For superposition theory, the biggest difference is non-orthogonality. Linear independence is important because if they are not linear independent, then this scalar product take any value. I forgot to say, but linear independent also yields some constraint on the scalar products. So this is also important.
Thank you. So there is a question regarding the Krauss operators on your slide on page 5. So Sadi Turgut is asking what kind of measurements do these Krauss operators correspond to and what is their physical meaning?
F and K are our basis vectors. C, K are the complement of the basis vectors. If, for example, this is not necessary to equal to one, but if this subscript K, for example, if we have here C, K and C, J, if J and K is different, they are equal to zero. So the complement of different subscript of basis vectors are orthogonal. Is that clear? Is that enough for the? Is that enough answer for the question?
I'm not sure, but let me forward you a couple of more questions. And maybe it will become, they will also help. So there's another question about whether the relatively maximally superposition states converge to the maximally coherent state when the independent set of bases becomes orthogonal.
Sorry, Levent Hocam, can you repeat?
So the question is whether the relatively maximally superposition states converge to the maximally coherent states when the independent set of bases becomes orthogonal.
Yes, this is an important point of the problem. In the orthonormal limit, all the results here we obtain must be equal to the coherence. So here, for example, if we take these basis vectors orthonormal, all these, for example, here qubit system and high dimensional system, all these results are equal with coherence theory. For example, here if we take mu equal to zero and C1, C2 orthonormal, for example, qubit systems is equal to maximal state for qubit system. This is also true for high dimensional systems. We have to check this orthonormal limit. So yes, in the orthonormal limit, we are equal.
Okay, related to this linear dependence, Sadi Turgut is asking whether coherent states being linearly dependent would cause a problem.
Being a linearly dependent cause problem on what? Sorry, Antonin, can you repeat?
The fact that the coherent states form a linearly dependent set.
Okay. I didn't understand.
Okay, maybe there is some. So there is one more question. Unless there is maybe clarification on the problem Sadi Hoca is referring to. Let me close with this. Onur Pusuluk is asking if there is any physical example in which the superposition of non-orthogonal states naturally appears. If there is a natural setup where the superposition of non-orthogonal states shows up.
In the conclusion, I said, for example, the optical coherent states are non-orthogonal. For this case of states, I can say for optical coherent states, I don't know whether there is another example, but I can say optical coherent states are not orthogonal, which is given as an example. Probably I didn't explain the questions well. Sorry for this.
That's okay. I think this is, there will be more opportunity to discuss in more detail, maybe during the poster session meeting or otherwise. So let me stop here because I have already used 10 minutes of the break, I'm afraid, and thank all the speakers of this session one more time, and also thank the organizers for the all the arrangement and management of the meeting. So as I said, we will reconvene and continue at 15:50, so 10 to 4 local time. I hope I don't need to make another announcement or Ceyhun Hocam, would you like to say something before we stop for a break? Okay, I received a message from the organization committee that we can pause here for about 20 minutes. So see you in 20 minutes.